Okay, so welcome to the third lecture of this series. In the first lecture, we motivated the study of theories with scale invariants, and I told you that usually Poincaré plus scale invariants imply in physical systems full conformal invariants. Then we defined conformal transformations, and we wrote down the full action of the conformal transformations. These are the finite actions. Here, A mu and B mu are constant vectors. Alpha is a real number, and this M is a matrix. I will say later that I find some properties of this M. Then, in the second lecture, then we work out the action of infinitesimal conformal transformations on functions, and we use that in order to compute the conformal algebra. Some of the important things that we will use today will be the commutation relation of the dilatation in P mu. This is I P mu. Then, for instance, you can compute also this one. So this is a sublist. It's a subset of the ones I introduced yesterday. But you will see in a second why this subset is important. Then you have L mu mu with P rho. And this is equal to minus I eta mu rho P mu minus eta mu rho P mu. And that's it. And well, this you know. Before I start, is there any questions about the first two lectures? I mean, you may have digested some of the material and you got confused, you are confused about something. Is that okay? If you are too confused, you are too confused even to ask something. So, is there anyone with the right degree of confusion? So, we will start. So, in the last lecture, we define how conformal transformations act on functions or on space-time coordinates. However, if you have a theory, in general, your theory has operators, and then we need to define how conformal transformations act on operators too. And in the first hour of today, that's what we will do. We will define that. Now remember that in quantum field theory, symmetries are realized as operators and these operators can act either on the Hilbert space and that is what is usually referred to in quantum mechanics as the Schrödinger picture. Or they can act on operators. You can denote with operators like this, and this is what is usually called the Heisenberg picture. So this is the view that we will follow in defining how conformal transformations act on operators. Good. So let's imagine now. So imagine that in your theory you have an operator phi alpha of x. And by this alpha, what I mean is that this operator is multi-component. And the operator in general will have more than one component if it has a non-trivial Lorentz spin. The operator could also be spinless, so it's a scalar operator, and then we won't have an index, or we will have just one index. Is that okay? So I have operators in my theory, and these operators may have a spin. They may have a spin 1/2, a spin 1, etc., and the number of components depends on that. Now, the strategy, in order to understand how these transformations act on operators, is to first focus in the stability group. The stability group, by definition, is the group that leaves the origin invariant. You have to pick a point. We pick the origin. If you want to be even more precise, you should call this group the stability point of the origin, or at the origin. And then we choose the group, the subgroup, among the conformal transformations on my left, that keep the origin invariant. So, for this case, for the present case, this group is spanned by now, can you tell me what are the elements of the conformal algebra that leave the origin invariant?
Dilatations,
good.
Rotations,
very good.
And a special conformal.
And a special conformal, absolutely. So, everybody but translations. There is a nice way to see that the special conformal transformations leave the origin invariant. Well, there is an easy way. The easy way is you come here and you set x to 0. And you see that x prime is also equal to 0. But there is a nicer way, and it's remember that conformal invariants are also conformal invariants are also the composition of the inversion with the translation with the inversion. So you could imagine that you have the origin, then you make an inversion, so you end up at infinity, you translate infinity, so you are still at infinity, and you invert back, and you get to the origin. So I was very excited. And then I did not see this. Anyway, so it's trivial, but indeed, the three elements, sorry, the three kind of elements that preserve the origin are this one. So this is the stability group at the origin. And then what we do is we define the properties of our operator. So we define the properties of our operator. Again, here you have this thing, Latin thing. Okay. Of our operator. By saying how the stability group, how the elements of the stability group act at the origin, or how our operator transforms at the origin. And then, from the origin, we will translate to any point x. So this is, well, mathematically it's called the theory of induced representations. It was introduced in Italy, actually, in Trieste ICTP by Mack and Salam in the 69s. So it's what people use. So basically, we consider our field at the origin. And then remember that in the Heisenberg picture, or in quantum field theory in general, operators act by commutation relation on these operators. So we define, we say that our operator under dilatation transforms like this. And this index lambda, this number, delta, sorry, is the scaling dimension of the operator. Notice that, well, because of this plus sign here, P will raise the dimension of the operator, will give you from delta to delta plus one. If you look at the literature, there are many conventions. In half of the books, this sign is wrong. And in other, well, sorry, in one third, the sign is wrong. In the other third, they use the other convention at which K raises the dimension. But that is the convention we will use at this course. So by definition, our operator satisfies this. And this is by definition the scaling dimension of the operator. Then we also say that by definition, our operator satisfies the following. So L mu nu acting on the field at zero is equal to I S mu nu, I will tell what this I is, in a second, what is alpha beta psi beta at zero. Now, this S is a matrix. This is a matrix, and it's a matrix that, of course, the dimension of the matrix has to be equal to the number of indices here. So this depends on the spin, or Lorentz spin, of the operator. For the particular case of a scalar operator, S is actually equal to zero. But this treatment is true for general operators too. So by definition, our operator is defined by these two properties. So I got a question about the Cartan subalgebra yesterday. So this is how we define our operator. Our operator now will have two labels. One label is delta, and the other label is the SOD representation. And this is the representation under the Lorentz group. Is that all right? And if you imagine the SO2, D representation, imagine a big matrix of D plus 2 times D plus 2, and this matrix has two blocks, a 2 by 2 block, and this is the dilatation operator, and a D by D block. And this one. Is that okay? Sorry.
Yes. I have a question. Can I insist on the question? Maybe it's a trivial thing, but I don't understand why we don't pick the momenta as a Cartan subalgebra. In SO2, 4, that would be 4 dimensional, right? So it just looks like bigger.
No, in SO, well, no, even in SO2, 4, you define your operator. The way you define your operator in conformal field theories is by telling what is the Lorentz spin of the operator. Of course, the Lorentz spin is then SU2 times SU2. And there you have, you usually take the diagonal or something like that. But even in four dimensions, you do.
I disagree, but it's you have three numbers. Right?
Sure, sure. But this is more than a number. It is a representation, if you wish.
Yeah. Okay. You know, I guess they should look up in some. It's a group theory question, actually. I mean, why the momenta are not a fractal subalgebra?
Well, I mean, they don't even commute with D, right? So you start
right.
With D. So let me put this. So you know that the yeah.
I probably what I don't really remember is the definition.
Well, the elements of the Cartan subalgebra commute with each other, and that's why you can define eigenstates with respect to all of them. And P doesn't commute with D.
Well, but they commute with.
They commute with each other, and you could do that. But that's not powerful enough. That doesn't carry enough information. So what they do, what in usually in conformal field theories, is they choose D and L with commutes with this. So yeah. I mean you could choose, but maybe other algebras. I mean you could choose the P's or you could choose the K's. But actually, let me answer your question in a second.
Okay.
So and you will see. So far, did you understand? I mean, this is how we define our operator. I mean, we say that our operator at the origin satisfies this and satisfies this. And this is telling what is the delta of the operator. So by definition, the delta is the number that appears here. And this is what is the Lorentz representation or Lorentz spin of our operator. In addition, we require another condition, and that is, so this is condition one, this is condition two, then we have condition three. I want to keep that, I think by the end of my lecture on Friday, I will get good at using this way, this blackboard. In the UK, they have changed the whiteboards because 0.1% of the population cannot see very well. Also, all the blackboards are out and there is only whiteboards. And they are quite different to use. Anyway, so then the last property we will require is that K mu with phi alpha at zero is equal to zero. And this we take as the defining property. Now, rigorously, this is the defining property of primary operator. So, an operator, so we say precisely that an operator is primary, so phi is primary if it is annihilated by the special conformal transformations at the origin. And this is the rigorous definition of a primary operator. We will see in a second how this connects to what we said yesterday, but this is true. Now, you see here, actually, if you define your Cartan subalgebra, etc., like this, you can consistently set this. And this is something that you want to do in conformal field theories. Now, Actually, it turns out, so you could try to be smart, but let me try to be smart here, and put something on the right-hand side. You could try to put something on this right-hand side. But actually, one can prove that the Schur's lemma implies that the right-hand side of this commutator has to be zero, if the field or the operator is in an irreducible representation of the Lorentz group. So, actually, if you assume that your operator has some Lorentz spin and transforms in an irreducible representation, you can prove that this is actually the case. Translated to English, this simply means that the operator is not the derivative of another. And that's what we said yesterday. With operators could be split into two, into primary operators and operators that are descendant of some primary, meaning you can act with the derivative of something. If you act it with the derivative, it won't be in a irreducible representation anymore. So this wouldn't be true anymore for an operator which is not a primary. But for a primary, it is, and we can take as the definition of primary. So, for the moment, all what we have done is, we have said, let's go to the origin, and let's define how the stability group, the group spanned by D, L, and K, acts on our operator. And by definition, D acts like this, with some scaling dimension delta. The Lorentz subgroup acts like this, where this depends on the spin of the operator, and K annihilates the guy at the origin, provided the guy is prime. Is that okay? So, that is the rigorous definition of primary operators in conformal field theory. It's operators that at the origin behave like this. So, one has to be careful. Sometimes people say that primary operators are annihilated by K. This is true only at the origin. It's not true always. Questions?
Sorry. Yes. Can you comment a bit on the presence of quasi-primary operators?
Yes, absolutely. I could comment. That's a very important question. Actually, well, my comment is actually very nice. So this is the only aspect in which my course is easier than the course in 2D. Because in 2D, you have a difference between primary and quasi-primaries. In higher dimensions, there is no difference. That's my goal. So actually, in more than two dimensions, you don't need to talk about quasi-primaries. So they agree. And this is, that's it.
So if I have another operator in the stability group that kills my field at the origin, I have two primary operators.
Yeah, actually, you can have, we will see, we will have an infinite number of primary operators. Yes. And, well, in this sense, the structure is richer. So I will talk about the structure in the next lecture, I hope. Yes. So, but indeed, what will happen, we will have, given a primary operator, you can construct an infinite tower of descendants. But actually, we will have an infinite tower, like an infinite number of primary operators. And each of them, so each primary together with all the descendants, will transform in a representation of the conformal group. Now, in two dimensions, you have the Virasoro algebra, so an infinite number of these representations repack into a Virasoro representation. So the structure is a little bit different. But here, in a way, it's simpler. It's harder to do computations with, because the symmetry is much smaller. But the picture is that you have a primary, and given a primary, you have a whole bunch of an infinite tower of descendants, but then you can have many primaries. Actually, we will see at the end of the lecture, we will discuss a theory n equals 4, for instance, and you will see that there is even a lot of operators with the same delta and the same spin. So even fixing delta, you can have a lot of operators. Yeah, so that gives some headaches, but yeah, any other questions? Good. So what we have done now is we have defined our operator. We have said that at the origin, our operator satisfies this. This. And this. Sorry, I could as well write a little here. Good. So now, since we have the properties of our operators at the origin, what we will do next is we will translate very quickly. Well, let me put L. Fine. But I just mean that, of course. I. Fine. Hold on, zero. So what we will do now is we will translate these relations to any arbitrary points. I mean, unless your theory is very boring, the operators will depend on x, and so we need to define the proper relations at x. And as we will see, actually the operation, the transformations at x will follow from these relations together with the algebra that I wrote on the right. Now, in order to do this, we remember that in the Heisenberg picture, the x dependence of an operator is given by this. Right? And then, given this, I think the most beautiful thing to do is you just take derivative with respect to x. If we do that, then here on the left-hand side, we have d mu of phi alpha x. Now, this derivative can hit the first exponential or the second exponential. Well, not all, both of them, first one and then the other one. And then, when we hit the first exponential, we get minus I p mu phi at zero. Let me forget about the index for a second. And when we hit the second exponential, we get plus I phi zero p mu times e to the I dx. Is that okay? We just have taken derivatives with respect to x. Now this, actually, is simply minus I times the commutator of p mu with phi of x. So what I have done this P commutes with P, so I can enter this inside, and I can enter, well, this guy is just here, so we have phi of x, and the guy inside is just minus I times P phi minus phi P, and that's the commutator. Is that all right? Good. So, what this implies, actually, is then that the commutator of P mu with phi alpha x is equal to I d mu of phi alpha x. So this defines, this tells us how P mu acts, or how the operator transforms under P mu. Is that okay? And that will be one of our defining properties of the operator. So this is an important formula. Then we can also work the other ones. So let's once we have this here, let me use this whiteboard. So let's say that you want to compute d with phi of x. Right. So this is equal, am I giving too many details in my computation? Is it good? Do you like it like that? It's fine. It's good. I see. So this is equal to d, I am going to be painful here, but e to the minus ipx, phi 0, e to the ipx, minus e to the minus ipx, phi 0, e to the ipx, times t, right? Just by definition of commutator. But this, you can write as e to the minus ipx, so we just multiply and divide by, well, we multiply by 1 in many places, but then we write 1 in a funny way, like this times this, and then this is d e to the minus ipx times phi 0 minus phi 0 e to the ipx d e to the minus ipx times e to the ipx. So I haven't done anything from the first to the second line. I just multiply by 1. But then this can be written as e to the minus ipx times the commutator of d prime with 0, with phi at 0, times e to the ipx. I am being very slow because this is a useful trick that you can use in many other places. Now, where I have introduced d prime, which is simply this, ipx d e to the minus ipx. Notice that I have written d, I could have put a cow here, and everything goes through. So I never use the properties of d. So this will work for any generator. So you can put L, you can put K, and everything follows through. Up to here. So here it will matter in a second. Is that okay? So this computation is actually completely general. I just chose d for definiteness. Good. So now, notice that we want to compute this guy here. So let's put this. So we will put the improved ones here, the ones at x. Now we need to compute d prime. And in order to compute d prime, I usually prefer the method that is not too smart. because then, well, for one thing, because I am not too smart. But the second thing is that you can see how everything works. So let's be very explicit in computing this d prime. Now, if you want to compute it, you see that d prime over there is equal to, you just expand this exponential. So this is 1 plus ixp minus xp squared over 2, dot, 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 d times 1 minus ixp minus xp squared over 2 plus dot, dot, dot. And then you see that the first term, so now you start expanding the products, you can see that the first term is just d. The second term is I x mu p mu d. So here I should have this. And the second term, you can check that this x mu x nu, and then the commutator of p mu with the commutator of p nu with d. Plus, etc. But you can actually check that the third term will be proportional to x mu nu rho, and then the commutator of p with the commutator of another p with the commutator of p with d, and so on. And notice that again, here yet I haven't used the properties of d. So this could have been any operator of the algebra. Is that okay? So this term is very easy to see. This takes 5 minutes, but you can also see. Now, it comes a beautiful thing. Imagine that this d is actually d, for once, right? Then the commutator of d with p is p, right? But then you know that p commutes with p. So this term here is already zero. Because once you say that this is proportional to p, then here you have zero. And you have zero for all the others as well, right? So the CES actually truncates just here. Now, if instead of d, you take, let's say, l, well, the same will happen. Because the commutator of l with p is p, right? And then in the second term is the third term, sorry, the second non-trivial term is already zero. Now, if you take k in the first commutation, in this commutation, you get d and l. So this commutator is non-trivial. This is non-trivial. But actually, the next one is trivial. And so on. So for k, you have to consider only 3 of these guys. So this, this, and this. While for all the others, only 2 are enough. So it's a beautiful thing that actually the CES truncates so quickly. So you don't need, here you may start crying because you say, oh no, I have, you know, like an infinite exponential, and then you have to keep going forever. But you don't. And so this is just it. Any questions? Good. So now, so it is a beautiful feature that this symmetry truncates, and then you see that d prime is just d plus I x mu, the commutator of p mu with d, but this is just d, and the commutator of p mu with d is I p mu, sorry. Sorry about that. So this is the commutator of d with p is ip, but the commutator of p with d is the opposite. That was less. Okay. It was a disaster for conformal theory. So this is just this. One has to be careful with the signs. Is that all right? So, p with D is minus D with P, so you have a minus I. I times minus I is 1. So this is just this. Is that all right?
Yes.
Good. So what we have proven, is that then, if we want to compute this, D with phi of x, we need to compute this, times the commutator of D prime with phi 0, times this. But now, the beautiful thing is that then, the commutator of D prime with phi 0 is the commutator of D plus xp with phi 0. And because of our definition, because we have defined our operator as to satisfy this, we know how these guys act at 0. Right? So, from this, we deduce that this guy here, so D with phi of x, is equal D with phi of x is equal to I delta, and this comes from the definition of the origin, plus a contribution that comes from P, and this is x mu, t mu, phi alpha. Is that clear? So, this now, we could look at this relation here, and then for all points, x is replaced by this. Any questions? Yes?
So the phi alpha should be evaluated to the x or 0?
That's a good question. So let's do it slowly. So what we have seen is that, let me erase here. So what we have seen is that d phi of x is equal to e to the minus ipx times the commutator of d prime, but then we computed d prime, and we saw that this is d plus x dot p on 0, e to the ipx, right? But then this is equal to I to the minus IPX. Now, V acting on phi of 0, the commutator is just I delta phi alpha 0, and P commuted with this is plus I X D at 0. So the way to interpret this is you take the derivative and then it's like a Taylor expansion, times e to the ipx. And then you use these guys to translate again this field to x. And you get precisely this with the field at x. So basically we translate to 0, right? At 0 we know what happens and then we translate back. So that's all the things we do. And we say that the algebra on the right has induced this transformation here from the properties at the origin. Is that okay? So I will not need this anymore. you could work out the result of all the other generators. L works also in exactly the same way as D, and you have a piece that comes from the origin, and another piece that comes from the commutation of P. With L, so this is the result, and then finally the longest of all is this. So here, remember, we have to go up to second order, so always has an alpha, beta, and this is beta, and then there are two pieces, that is I, 2x mu, x dot with the derivative, and phi, alpha of x minus x squared, d mu, phi alpha. Well, it's just what you get, but it follows directly from the algebra. In particular, you see on the right-hand side that if you set x to 0, we recover the properties at the left-hand side. Are there any questions? So, this is how infinitesimal conformal transformations act on operators of our theory. I mean, this we will see today, but we will see the consequences of this over the next lectures. But before we move on to the next subject, let me tell you that from these infinitesimal transformations, you can also work out the finite transformations on an operator. So we can see how operators transform under finite conformal transformations. And, well, I don't need too much, actually. And I will quote the result. So from this, you could work out the finite transformations. it is easy to do it for scalars. We will deal, I think, tomorrow with, I will tell you what happens for specific non-scalar ones, meaning spinless. And you can actually see that as x goes to x prime, which is a function of x, and this is a conformal transformation, then the field, the operator phi, goes to phi prime x prime, which is equal to the Jacobian. So if the determinant of the Jacobian matrix for the conformal transformations, 2 the minus delta divided the number of dimensions d, times the original operator. This will be extremely important tomorrow. But so this is how a conformal transformation acts. It multiplies each field by a function of x, but this function is very specific. It's exactly that. Now, this could be put in a slightly nicer form. Actually, this is the form we will use tomorrow. But if you want to put it in a nice form, remember that conformal transformations, you could compute the Jacobian of this transformation, and this was the rescaling that entered in front of the matrix, of the metric, to the minus t over 2. So actually, you could also write this as that. So basically, the field, if the metric rescales with a factor lambda, the field rescales with a factor lambda to the delta over 2, where delta is the scaling dimension of the field. It's so much, I could almost have said this at the beginning, and you would have believed me, I guess. But okay, but this derivation is much needed. Thank you. So I think this is a good place to stop for 5 minutes. In the next one, I will, since I want to make this course self-contained, I will remind you some facts about continuous transformations or transformations on Q conformal field theories. Sorry, quantum field theories, and the most important results. Some of you may have seen them already, but they will be useful in what follows. So thank you. So symmetries in QFT sounds like the name of a workshop by itself. So, but it will be just a small reminder of some facts. So what we have seen, so let's just start. Probably we have to end tomorrow about this, but we will recall some important facts about the usual issue. So let's recall some facts about symmetries in quantum field theories. Now, conformal transformations act on fields as they act on a space-time. So we will see. So we will study the following problem. Imagine that we have an action. Like this. So this action, in general, contains a field and derivatives, and this is in general a collection of fields. Collection of fields is important for this treatment that only first derivatives of the fields appear. And then we imagine that we do a general transformation. We are not going to restrict to conformal transformations for a while. So we do the transformation x goes to x prime, which is equal to some function of x. And then the field phi goes to phi prime x prime, which is some function of phi of x. So this is the transformation we do. It's pretty general transformation. So let's see what happens with the action. So when we do that, the transform action, well, the usual way this is introduced is as follows. Is you compute the action in the transform field like that. So this is the action after the transformation. Now, notice that this x is an integration variable, is a dummy variable, so we can put any name we like. So we can call it x prime. By the way, I heard a story of a Harvard professor teaching calculus in biology for students of biology, and they told them how to solve integrals with some function of x times dx. And for the exam, they put a function of y times dy, and the students didn't know what to do. Anyway, so here we are doing this, so I hope you know what to do with it. So this is just,
he was very surprised.
So here we just recall the variable x, and now this. Is equal to this. Now, phi prime of x prime is f by definition, phi of x, t prime mu acting on phi of x. And here we can write down everything in terms of x, provided we put the Jacobian here. Here we have f of x, and here you have dx mu, dx prime mu, d mu of f. Is that okay? So we just introduce this this very simple change of variables. So we start with our action, which is given by this, and after the transformation, our action looks like this for any transformation, not necessarily conformal. So let's focus in some examples that we have seen. So for instance, if we have translations, and here x prime mu is equal to x mu plus 8 mu, and the transform field is just this, so these are the property of translations. So notice in particular, so the two elements I need in order to compute this matrix are dx mu, dx prime mu, but this is just delta mu mu for translations. And for translations, this function f, capital F, is just the identity. F stands for Fernando. So you see that actually S is the same as S prime, provided the action, so there is no explicit dependence on X. And this, I guess you knew, but okay, if I hand you an action and I ask you, is that action invariant under translations? If the action has only fields and derivatives of the field, then it is invariant. If it has an x, then it is not invariant. You have seen this in quantum mechanics with time probably. Is that all right? Is that okay? Good. So this tells us whether our theory is classically invariant under translations. We can consider another example, and let's discuss. So the second example is a little bit more interesting, and it's that of Lorentz transformations. So Lorentz transformations, I will use a notation that is more commonly used in quantum field theory, is defined like this. while the field of the transformed coordinate is equal to some matrix acting on the field. And here you should imagine a component, alpha, beta, alpha, beta, and beta. But I will write it like that and hope it is clear. So this, this is how fields transform under Lorentz transformations. We have seen the infinitesimal version of this. I will mention the relation in 1 second. Now, as matrices, so these guys are not arbitrary. Actually, as matrices, they have this rho, eta, nu, sigma has to be. So they satisfy this. They are all the matrices satisfying this. And these matrices satisfy a group, and the name of this group is the Lorentz group. I think I broke a lot. This is the Lorentz group, and then these matrices L form a representation. The Lorentz group. Now, and of course, the dimension of this representation depends on the spin of your field. So, if the field is it's a scalar, then this L is just one. It's just the number one. If it is a spin, it will be related to Pauli matrices, etc. So infinitesimally, so in order to make a connection with what we had before, infinitesimally, this L lambda, so I just mentioned this very quickly and related to the discussion, so just in parentheses, infinitesimal, this is the identity matrix minus 1/2 omega rho nu, where this is the infinitesimal parameter of the Lorentz transformation times a matrix rho nu. And this is the matrix S we introduced it before. Is that okay?
Just a stupid question.
Yes.
Shouldn't the definition of the Lorentz group be with the eta number switched on the left hand side? Lambda transpose this lambda.
And there's just one lambda instead of it's just that
you wrote. Oh, sorry. So here you have one lambda eta lambda. Is that true? Yeah,
it's,
I think you're right.
It's eta lambda lambda.
Eta lambda, yeah.
Sorry, I do have eta lambda lambda in my mind. Yeah, I do. Absolutely, sorry. Yeah, so sorry, that wasn't right. It is like this, yeah. So this is the Lorentz group. So all what I said was correct, but what I wrote wasn't. So, but this is the correct definition. Yeah. Now, for these transformations, actually, for Lorentz transformations, one can check. So what is true is that for Lorentz transformations, the Jacobian of these it is actually one. This is because remember that Lorentz transformations were an isometry, so the Jacobian of this transformation was equal to one, and S prime is simply dvx times the Lagrangian of L lambda, lambda to the minus one, acting on delta, L lambda phi. So this is the action after we transform it. So, for instance, if we have only scalar fields, only scalars, then L is equal to the identity matrix, is equal to 1, and then the action is invariant, S is equal to S prime, provided the derivatives appear in a Lorentz invariant way. Again, translated to English, this simply means that the derivative should be contracted. So, if you have d mu, well, like if you have an action something like this, derivatives are contracted. If you have something like this, they are not. So, what we have just said is, it was quite well-known facts, but it actually tells us whether an action is classically invariant under the Poincaré group. So, I have to say, if I give you a theory, and if you want to check whether your theory is conformal invariant or not, first you need to check whether it's classically conformal invariant. And that's what we are doing now. The next lecture, we will try to see quantum conformal invariance. That's a little harder. But for the moment, let's focus on classical. So, an action is classically invariant under translations if it doesn't have an explicit dependence on x, and is classically invariant under Lorentz transformations if all the derivatives are nicely contracted. Is that all right? Good. And it just follows from this very cute formula. Questions? So let's go now to the last example. So now we can focus in dilatations or scale transformations. So the third example. This is scale transformations. This is big enough on the back. Yeah. So scale transformations, remember, take x prime to lambda x, and they take the field lambda x to lambda minus delta of the field, where this delta is the scaling dimension of the field. And in particular, from this expression, you see, from this expression here, you see that the Jacobian of the transformation is simply lambda to the d, to the number of dimensions. Just this. So we come to the action. We replace all the ingredients, and we see that the action S prime is equal to lambda to the d, d dx, times L lambda to the minus d phi lambda to the minus 1 minus delta, sorry, lambda to the minus delta phi d mu of phi. Well, it's not obvious when d this is invariant or not, but let's focus on a simple example. So imagine we have the action just for a scalar field, and it's just the free one, so we want to see whether the free part is a scale invariant. So if we have this, you can check that this is invariant, you just replace this here, and you can check that this is invariant, provided the delta for the scalar field is 1/2 of d minus 1. So at the classical level, actually, we don't check invariance under dilatation. We go to the free field, which we know will be there, and then we require that this is invariant under scale transformations, and that fixes what the dimension of the field has to be. Is that okay? So now, once we have that, so this is a nice result, by the way. I mean, when you, for instance, when you hear, you may have heard that the scalar field has dimension 1 in 4 dimensions, this is the reason for it. So if you put d equals 4, 4 divided by 2 is 2 minus 2 is 1. So that's the reason why a scalar field has dimension 1 in 4 dimensions. You could try to add a term to this, for instance. We could say, well, I want some lambda phi to the n, right? And now we have already fixed the dimension of phi. So we don't have that freedom anymore. So we see that this term here, so if you have this phi to the n, this goes to lambda to the d divided lambda to the n delta, dx phi to the n, and this is invariant provided this is equal to 1, right? And this equal to 1 implies that n has to be d over delta, or using the previous result, 2d over d minus 2. So for instance, if you're in 4 dimensions, n is equal to 4. So in 4 dimensions, you can introduce a field phi to the 4. And, well, connecting to the first lecture, that explains why phi to the 4 in 4 dimensions was already scale invariant classically. So it had this b to the 0. Is that all right? Any questions, comments? Good. So let's try to go. So this is one thing.
Sorry,
so
is it possible to let a coupling constant with a scale?
It is, okay. If you say that the coupling constants don't transform, now, if you have a scale, really, the scale, I don't think the scale transforms. I mean, what will happen, so, I think that the correct statement is the following. It's actually quite the opposite. If here you added a term that is m squared phi squared, right, then this term would break conformal invariance. Because, so, there are two ways of seeing three, well, there are three related issues, and I think they will answer your question fully. So, the first thing is conformal invariance act on, so scale invariants act on space-time coordinates, and they act on the fields, but they don't act on the parameter m, right? And this is the reason why this breaks conformal invariance. Now, you may have heard that you cannot add up oranges plus tomatoes, You cannot do that. So three oranges plus two tomatoes is three oranges plus two tomatoes. Now it is not five. So the reason why you could add these two things is because M has a dimension. So you are adding inside the action things with the same mass dimension. So the reason why the power of five here is different than here, see, with this being dimensionless, implies that this is dimensionful. So the fact that M is dimensionful is related to the fact that it will break conformal invariance. It breaks conformal invariance, sorry, scale invariance, because if this guy is massless and this guy, sorry, dimensionless, and this guy is dimensionful, then the powers of phi have to be different. And so one of them will preserve conformal invariance and the other scale invariance and the other will not. And that is related to our physical intuition that if you introduce a scale, then you break the invariance. Is that clear? So once you have fixed the dimension of phi because of this, and then you say, okay, I can interchange derivatives by appropriate powers of phi. But then, well, you could add this, but you couldn't add this one. Is that all right? Without breaking scale invariance, yes.
Doesn't this apply for 2D also? Or, I mean,
well, yeah. In 2D, it's everything is quite different. And the dimension, I think that...
I mean, the scalar field is dimensionless.
Yeah.
But...
Exactly. So, indeed, that's a very good point. So, since in 2D, the scalar field is dimensionless, you could add any power of the scalar field. And that agrees with the fact that in two dimensions, this symmetry is infinity. In a way, it's infinite. Yeah. So this treatment is fine for D bigger than 2. For D equals 2 is special. And there you could add any power of 5. And
well,
that would be
well,
fine.
But you need to have dimensionful parameters then. Because you have a D2x.
Well, so you just told me that phi is has dimension 0 into D.
That's right. That's right.
Mass dimension
0,
which
yes. Is, it doesn't scale.
Yeah, so you could add them. Well, it has mass dimension 0. That is a little different to say it doesn't scale. So you could add them to the action. But this treatment, to be safe, this treatment is for D bigger than 2.
Yeah, no, the only issue is that if you add them, then you have to have a mass parameter. I mean, you have to.
If they have mass dimension 0, then you could add them without any problem. But you should have some derivatives or some massive parameter in front.
Okay.
Yes. But D equals 2 is very, very particular.
Yeah.
So it's like a degenerate case of all this. So,
yeah, I don't want to commit too much.
Is that okay? Any other questions? Good. So let's now go to a very important result. And now, well, we remember this. So remember this formula here. So we worked the transform action. And now, let's for a second, well, for 20 minutes or so, focus on infinitesimal transformations. So, and we will study the effect of infinitesimal transformations. So, remember that we had already introduced, so it's a little bit ugly, but by now you are used to it, I hope. We have already introduced infinitesimal transformation of coordinates like this yesterday. So this omega A is a very small parameter, right? So it's just a fixed parameter, independent of the couplings. Now the fields will also transform. We say that phi prime x prime, now in general this is equal to f, but for an infinitesimal transformation, f is very close to the identity. And how close to the identity it is? Well, omega a, and then you have the same df to the omega a. So this is an infinitesimal transformation on both coordinates and fields. Now, we introduce the Nether theorem. I don't know, was she Italian or German? Yeah, the surname didn't sound very, but then Austria belonged to Italy or vice versa. Yeah. So the theorem says that to every continuous symmetry, of the action, one may associate a current. And this current is classically conserved. So, you may have saw how many here saw the Nether theorem before? Four, okay.
Sorry.
How many people here saw the Nether theorem before? Okay, five. Okay, plus all the time. That's fine. It's a good number. Now, there is a very nice trick. In order to prove this Nether theorem. So the symmetries we are talking about are, for instance, the first three symmetries we just discussed. So you have an action. The action is invariant under dilatations or under, but mostly the Poincaré. Think about Poincaré, which is true for any quantum field theory. Now, we start the proof, and since I want to make this course self-contained, I will not assume you know the proof. We will just prove it, because it's beautiful, I think, the proof. So, we will start by assuming that this, which I gave a name, number one, is a symmetry of the action. It's a symmetry of the action. What this means is that it leaves the action invariant. Don't you say? So it is something invariant. Sorry. It leaves the action invariant. Of course, if the finite transformation is a symmetry of the action, if you transform by a little bit, then it also works. But actually, there is an important point that we should remember. This is an action. It's a symmetry of the action, where this omega a is just a parameter. It doesn't depend on x. So it's some very small parameter. So it's like the a mu of translations, or like the omega mu of Lorentz. In the jargon here, you say that this omega a is rigid. So it's not local. So this means independent of x. Now, there is a very, very neat way to derive this. So the first thing we do is we promote this rigid parameter to a parameter which depends on x. So we have something rigid, now it's not rigid anymore. And then we plug this transformation in the action, now with, where this omega depends on x, and then we try to understand from the formula I just erased, what is the transformation, what is the variation of the action. And what you find, is the following. What you find is that delta S is minus, so this, what I mean is S prime minus S, but after an infinitesimal variation, so this is very small, so it's infinitesimal variation of the action. Is minus ddx j a mu d mu omega a. Question. Could have been any other way? Or was this bound to happen? Really, what I wrote is basically a tautology. The transformation is first order, right? If it is first order, it can have only omega linearly, and it has to depend on omega linearly. The original action you started with had only fields and derivatives of fields. So in general, the variation of the action can have only two terms, one proportional to omega and another proportional to d omega. But we know that when omega doesn't depend on x, this has to be zero. So the piece proportional to omega goes away. Good. So really, I haven't written anything, right, that you already didn't know. Of course, if you plug this into the Lagrangian and then you compute the variation, you can compute what is the precise form of this J. And that is the information, the new information that I am giving to you. Is that all right? So this is very, it's very neat because we see, so if this omega didn't depend on x, this could be zero. So we don't get any mileage out of it. But as saying that omega depends on x, we get this. I will tell, but give me 1 second. Now, if you plug everything, then you obtain the following. So what you obtain is that this current this expression. So let's say you have a field. So it's the derivative with respect to this is the nu of this minus delta mu nu L. But then the indices, you have nu on nu, so we need to contract them with this minus, and there is another term that is the derivative of L with respect to the derivative of the field times this. So we have this. With this. Yes.
So the argument was you can have just omega and derivative of omega.
Yes.
Why not higher derivatives?
Ah, because the action you started with had only first derivatives. If you would have started with an action with higher derivatives, then you could have had higher derivatives. But we are assuming that also when you compute the Lagrange, the Euler-Lagrange equations, is usually an assumption. So the action we started with has only first derivatives. So when you plug the form of infinitesimal transformations here, there is only one derivative acting here. So you can only have this. Yeah. But that's an important assumption. So the action we start with has only first derivatives. Good. Really, to be fair, classically, you know that second derivatives of a field are related to the field itself. So you can also probably use the equations of motion to reduce to just first derivatives or integration by parts. Now, so given this result, so now we take this action and we do integration by parts that we know how to do. And if we do this, so here there is an assumption of how fields decay at infinity, but I will just, I will not worry about this. And then you can actually show that the variation of the action is actually something like this. Where this, remember, depends on x. Now, if the field configuration, so what happens if you have a field configuration, that satisfies the classical equations of motion, and you perturb the action a little bit, what do you get? Do you remember? So remember that fields that satisfy the equations of motion are a stationary point of the action. So if you change the action a little bit, and let's say you change the action just by this and this, any small configurations of the field actually gives you C. So delta S is actually zero. And I think it's really beautiful, the Noether's theorem. We started with something that was zero, then we have another zero, and from these two zeros we deduce something. So I think it's very smart and beautiful. So if we are perturbing around a classical field configuration that satisfies the classical equations of motion, then this delta S is equal to zero. And because this omega A is very small, but is actually it depends on X, so it's arbitrary, this implies that d mu j mu A is equal to zero. And this is the proof of the Noether theorem. So it is, I think it's very neat. I think the original paper didn't introduce this trick. So the original paper was, but it had already proven, I think, the form of the current, etc. Now, if you remember, so let me mention a couple of things. So the first thing, is there any questions about this proof? Oh. So basically, if you have a symmetry, right, you have an infinitesimal symmetry, then you can take your Lagrangian. From the Lagrangian, you can compute your current, and then you can prove that the current is conserved. Meaning, but it's classically conserved, so you may need to use the equations of motion in order to prove that d mu j mu is actually equal to c. But this is non-trivial, so it's already pretty cool. So everything is classical. Now, actually, from this, and people working in integrability, for instance, may find this useful, you can define a charge, a conserved charge, so basically, you take this guy, and you look at the time component of it, so the zero component, let's say, and then you integrate over all the other coordinates, and so here there is no time, and then you can prove that this guy is conserved. It's very simple. But if the fields decay enough at infinity. But you take time derivative of this, so this is d0 of j0, but you can write it like this and you have a surface. So that's it. The next thing I want to mention is that actually this j is not unique. This j is not unique. But actually, you can so what is called an improvement, so you can define it a little bit, and you can actually shift it. So this current here is usually called the canonical current. So it's the current that you get straight from the proof of the Nether's theorem. But actually, given this, you can always shift it by this, by some b mu a, such that b mu nu is minus b mu nu. And you could say, you would be able to see that conservation also works, and that this charge would be conserved as well. This will be important next lecture, where we will introduce the stress momentum tensor. So the stress momentum tensor, I have 2 minutes left, so I could speak for 2 minutes. So what we will see, so we will focus now, at the beginning of next lecture, we will focus on a specific infinitesimal transformations, which is just translations. And what we will be able to show is that, remember, that translations, so when you do a translation, omega A, remember, it's actually omega mu. So the index A is just a space times index mu. So well, before you call a current JA mu, now we have two indices, two Lorentz indices, and this is what usually people call the union, and it's the energy momentum tensor. The energy momentum tensor will play a very important role, so you can introduce it for any quantum field theory, but in conformal field theories, it's particularly powerful. But we will discuss all that tomorrow. So thank you.